Welcome to the second lecture in this course, History of Science, Technology, Innovation. Does anyone know what this is? This is Galileo giving you the finger. This is Galileo's finger, preserved in the Museum of History of Science in Florence, as a relic sort of one of the foremost scientists ever born, at least considered by many to be one of the most foremost scientists ever born. The finger that's sort of used to look on the manipulated telescope to look at the heavens and seeing things that no one had seen before. I'm using this because to show that what we're going to talk about now has been by many considered to be sort of a tumultuous and transformative period of human history. So much that sort of scientists of the day, of that day, is still celebrated, even venerated as sort of heroes, even somewhat as saints, you can say. Because here we have a sort of a relic of the scientific revolution. The middle finger of Galileo Galilei. Okay, first, just before we start, I just want to sort of give you some, show some of the feedback I got last time, which I thought was very good. Some said about the class, it was good, that very, very difficult lecture compared to what I'm used to. That was good, okay?
That's good.
Bad, difficult to start to act by this new way. I don't know exactly what that means, but it sounds promising. Maybe it means to start thinking in a new way, which I hope I'm gonna get you to do. Promising about the course, will most likely to give a new way of thinking. That's exactly what I hope to do anyway. What I hope to do after this course, that you will have a different view about science, technology, innovation than what you have now. Or at least hopefully you have already sort of starting to sort of think about at least technology and probably also science in somewhat different way than before. I'm promising nothing at this point. Very good, okay. Good, discussion, bad, maybe too philosophical on a tangent, but I still like it. Okay, maybe I was a little bit too philosophical last time, that's possible. But even though this is not a course in philosophy, of course we're gonna talk about sort of more general philosophical questions, because we're gonna talk about sort of what is the nature of science, technology, life to memories. Promising, thought-provoking, I like that. Unpromising, loud air conditioner. Yes, I agree, that was also very unpromising about the course. So I sort of turned down the air conditioner a little bit, and if we sort of start a discussion, I'm gonna go turn it off completely. If I don't forget, I mean, just remind me about that. Okay, good. Let's take a little look at this, sort of the questions that you sent in also before today, which was about, of course, the scientific method and sort of what have the scientific method in some ways influenced you, both as you, as individuals, but also sort of the larger part of your life. So that's why I asked you sort of to talk or to name what was of the scientific method that was influencing what you had on you at that moment and then also what you had in your homes. And here's some answers that have been sort of cooked together to some kind of descriptions, because I also asked you about stuff. And then stuff, many of you define that sort of as man-made, tangible, sort of physical things. Even though some went a little bit further and said normally material, but basically things in general. So stuff. Okay, scientific method then. Once again, this is a try to compile what many of you have said. Use of science, or someone at least said use of science, but that's somewhat circular, of course. But to explain events and use to forecast through systematic observation, measurements, and experiment. And then someone even went so far to say that scientific method is technology, basically arguing that all technology in some ways are results of the scientific method, or is scientific method, which I sort of argued against last class, but that person was talking about technology today. And that, I think, that's really worth thinking more about. And I hope you're gonna think more about that for next time, for the lab we're gonna have on Monday, because it's gonna be continuing this discussion about what is the scientific method and what has been the impact of the scientific method. Maybe I should put a question mark after that. Is scientific method technology, or is technology all about scientific method today? I would argue maybe not, but let's see what you're going to say next time also. Okay, a little bit more sort of detailed answers then. Here's some answers from what you talked about, what you had on you. Notes on paper, thoughts and beliefs, even someone went as far as say, was not a product of the scientific method. Otherwise, necklace, clothing, fur, jewelry, sort of man-made, handmade things, you can say. And also a handmade wool sweater, woolly socks, probably made by a granny or so, because that's going to come back later, grandmother or grandfather. No science involved, just tradition, someone said about these things that was sort of not scientific. And I think interesting is just tradition. It sort of implies in some ways that traditional things are non-scientific. But I would also argue in some ways maybe today even science has become part of our tradition, our modern tradition, some way, because it's been with us for so long. Okay, in your home then, pieces of rock, plants, flowers, fruits, organic food, even though the person said maybe, well, maybe even organic food are made by scientific method. Firewood, hides, pickled berries and mushroom, and then sort of plants and fruits, basically, things that you guys go out in the nature to pick. But so, because basically what many of you argue was everything produced today is a result of the scientific method. That's what many of you argued. In the sense that if they have been manufactured in some kind of company, then there have to be some kind of systematic thinking, experimentation, observation behind it. I think that's that. I hope we're going to talk more about that, because I think that's questionable in some ways. I mean, everything produced today, is that really a product of the scientific method? Well, think more about that, and especially think more about that for next time. Stone morsel, painting. Beautiful stones inside fish tank, one of you mentioned. Or parent-built wardrobe, granny-made quilt. And it's also both of these interesting, because it seems like a lot of these sort of non-scientific things are things that have been given sort of by relatives or sort of, and that they made by hand. And that also goes back to, in many ways, sort of the handmade things we have in our life now. Often they come from, either from exotic places, or maybe they come from close family and so on. Snail shell, aesthetic things, which connects to the painting there, of course. But then also furniture and cooking items, some would argue. But then also interesting, there was one person of you that sort of argued that actually, basically things that had been sort of invented without any planning behind it, so that was sort of coincidences or spin-offs that was not planned for that. In that sense, Teflon was a spin-off of the space program. And microwave oven was also sort of like a coincidental invention that you actually could use sort of microwave to heat up things or food, rubber. So that was sort of one argument made that actually that person then took the point that things that sort of come been invented without any planning or systematic sort of research and development behind it, they are sort of not results of the scientific method. Okay, and then the last comment here was, I said before also, that talking about things that was non-psychic, both from my travels around the world to rural areas. So once again, sort of many of these things that are sort of not cited, but also would go for sort of not handmade in a way from travels or from close relatives, I would say. Any comments, thoughts about this? Objections? As I say, we're going to come back to this next class on Monday also. So we're going to continue this discussion very much. Okay, what I'm going to do now, I'm going to talk about the scientific revolution, the first scientific revolution, going up to about 1700. And there are some discussions when it actually ends and so on. And it's going to be quite, I mean, a lot of things, because it's a long period. I'm going to go from sort of the 14th century up until 1700. So I'm going to miss a lot of things, of course. But my aim is to show in a way that maybe, well, this is about the birth of what we think about today as science. And sort of when science become getting some more systematic form. So that's sort of the whole point about this. But let's start here, because to see that even though science has changed a lot of things have not changed very much. Here you see student life in a medieval university. I mean, it could have been almost, if you had been dressed up in funny clothes, it could have been here that you sort of been sitting here. So in that sense, I mean, a lot of things, the university is a very conservative institution in that sense. The methods we're using to sort of produce science or to transmit science and not new knowledge is very sort of traditional in many ways. Sure, we're using PowerPoints now and we're using sort of maybe also some other sort of more modern pedagogical methods. But overall, it is sort of very traditional in that sense. So a lot of things, even though a lot of things change, a lot of things also stay the same. Yeah, so here's just very sort of roughly sort of overview, just to show you some of the heritage of the university here. A lot of the terms we have here goes back to long time, to the medieval time. Campus, tuition, students, classes, courses, lectures, faculty, professor, all of these terms are basically are with us still today because they're sort of they have been proven to be still durable in that sense. So there was a lot of sort of what the medieval university was about. But the interesting thing about the medieval university, which is a big difference from the universities today, is that medieval university was not about research. It was not about producing new knowledge. It was about sort of conveying already existing knowledge. I mean, sure, what I'm sort of conveying here is this sort of old knowledge in some sense, but I, myself, I'm a researcher. I'm doing research, so part of my job is to stay up or sort of on the latest, what's happening here. I mean, hopefully most of what I'm saying here is sort of, well, hopefully, I mean, a lot of things, I mean, maybe yesterday or a month ago, someone came up with some new results and sort of show things that I'm going to say here to be wrong. But I mean, that's the part of nature. That's part of science in that sense. It's part of reason. But overall, this what I'm sort of transmitting to you is the sort of general accepted view among the researchers that this is what happened, which of course might be revised and changed over time, like all research and all knowledge. But let's start then when we talk about sort of this scientific, what was the science before what we think today about science? What was the pre-revolutionary science? Because there was a science even before sort of modern science, we put it like that. And that's what's known as scholasticism or Aristotelianism or scholastic Aristotelianism. And it's called Aristotelianism because it goes back to Aristotle that we see here on the right-hand side. So the one of the ancient Greek philosophers going there next to Plato. And the point about this Aristotelianism, scholasticism, was that at this time it should be theology's handmaiden. It should help sort of people to understand the works of God better. It should serve sort of religion. It was about illuminating matters that was considered to be of theological interest. It was about learning about God through learning about his works, the beauty of the systematic nature of his works. And the Aristotelian science, or scientia, it's known this. This was modeled in many ways of Greek mathematical practice, Euclid's geometry, the famous case. And it's also was a number of sort of examples there that was very sort of very important. But still, a sort of very central to science. It was about experience. That was based on experience, sensory experiments, knowledge gained by someone that's familiar with things, sort of that knew about things. But it's also, and this is something that we sort of still have with us, but in a very different form. It's what's about coming up with demonstrative conclusions. It was basically about sort of to demonstrate how things were from certain premises. Basically, the main thought about scholasticism, we know everything. We know how the world is. We know how the world works. We know everything. Everything is known. Now it's just, and everything that you sort of have around you in nature can be explained from these known principles because we know that how things are. So we just about sort of demonstrate how it sort of it worked, how to go back to. That was sort of the main point about this. And Aristotelian philosophy of material substances was about natural philosophy. Today we may might describe it as physics, but this was sort of before physics. And it was about qualitative properties of things or matters, and about mathematics, which was about quantitative properties of material substances. Okay, so this is sort of the general view of science. But what we come here to, this is how the world was made up. Everything in the world that you saw around us was considered to be made of the five elements. Earth, water, fire, air, and then the fifth element, sort of this elusive, the ether, which was a little like a trump element in some ways. And then all of these elements then can transmute into each other. They can change from each other. They can change into each other. But these are how everything was composed of. So this is what things are made of. But then how did change happen in the world? Well, the change happened from four causes. There was four causes that ruled everything, how things sort of changed in the world. It was what's called final cause, because of something's purpose, because everything had a purpose. Sort of. And so then if the change was maybe because of approaching its purpose. It might be a material cause, both because of the thing it was made of fire, or made of earth and so on, that sort of directed it in certain directions. Moving course, because of the action that the object was in. And then a formal course, and that's because of a thing's nature. So basically, it was considered that all things, inanimate or animate things, were acting according to its nature also. So that's sort of how things are made. But then you also have the universe, the Aristotelian universe, which is basically This is the Aristotelian universe, where we have Earth in the center, because everything centered around the Earth. And then around it, you have the planets and the stars, and they were sort of fixed, you can say, on spheres, crystalline spheres, round spheres. They were also the one holding the planets and the stars and the sun also in place. And then they were moving around. These spheres were moving around. So everything revolved around the Earth. And then in the heavens, and the heavens was sort of like this perfect place. And if it is a perfect place, of course, everything has to be perfect there. So therefore, nothing changed in the heavens. Everything was sort of unchangeable. And it's also perfect circular motion. So everything in the heavens moved in circular motion, perfect circular motion. Because if it is the perfect place, it has to move in a perfect motion. And that's circular motion. Why on Earth then? Heavy body, and so that was the movements in sort of in the heavens. They were moving in this perfect circular motions in these crystalline spheres. And then you have heavy bodies on Earth. You have heavy bodies; they fall towards the center, and you have light bodies that rise from the center. So that's sort of the two main motion. This was known. Everybody knew that sort of was educated that this was the way the world works. This was how the world was and how everything was. Okay, but then. Then things changing. But then first of all, what's the goal of scholastic philosophy? Well, as I said, everything was known. So the goal of scholastic philosophy was basically to locate everything in its place. So it was to place, to order things, not finding out new things, because everything was known. It was about to order everything in its place. And there's also another point, which makes it very different from science today, a lot of science today at least, is that there was a hands-off philosophy. It was about observing and contemplating nature, not to interfere with it. So basically, nature was not something to sort of to be controlled or manipulated. You should just sort of observe and contemplate, think about sort of its nature. So, but you shouldn't sort of interfere. That was not the point of science. Science was to understand and to order what was known. And to once again, to understand known phenomena. It was not about making new discoveries, because there was nothing new to discover. Everything was known. And if something that looked new coming up, then that could be explained according to what we already knew. But then, a number of things are happening, because then you see a number of new knowledges coming up, even though old knowledges in many ways, but getting more and more sort of attention during this period, especially from the 15th century onwards. One of the new knowledges, the new traditional knowledge traditions, is what's called Neoplatonism, or also known as Hermeticism. And this was sort of what can be described as maybe an occult knowledge. In 1460, Marsilio Ficino, one of the new scholar humanists in Italy, he translated a Hermetic corpus, a number of books that was supposedly written by Hermes Trismegistus, which was supposedly an ancient sage. An ancient sort of magi from, I don't remember if it was from Egypt or if it was from Mesopotamia, but it was supposed to be some ancient thing that had this sort of lost knowledge, that was sort of transmitted this lost knowledge. Today we know that this actually was a fake, this book. There was never any sort of ancient saying, but at this time everyone believed that this was true. And what is coming up in this newly discovered corpus is a number of new ways of looking at the world, especially what sort of about sort of, let's talk about that macro association, that things, small things in the world, sort of on the, it was also had connections to the stars. So basically it was an idea that actually what's happening on Earth had connections to what's happening in the skies and vice versa. So, and also that actually you could manipulate this. You could actually sort of change what was happening in the skies and in the Earth vice versa by sort of manipulating what's happening on the Earth. It was also about that there was some hidden mathematical meanings and forces. The world was filled suddenly. The world was filled with unknown things, or at least secrets, things that were not revealed. So there was hidden things, hidden associations, hidden rules, hidden laws, forces at least, maybe not so much laws at this time. So this is a new thing. But then you have also a number, connected to this, you have a number of other occult sciences that got more and more attention from the 15th century onwards. And once again, the important thing about this, for a long part of history of science, this has been sort of ruled out. This was just a crazy thing and stuff. We know that this is not true, so this was not important. Sure, you had some what we consider to be scientists that were also interested in this, but this was just another thing. But actually, more and more now, researchers, historians of science are starting to look at this more and more because they find out that a number of things about these occult sciences that then sort of carried over into what we think about as modern science. Especially was this a big idea about secrets, and that there was actually new things to be known. There were things that you can uncover, you can discover things, you can discover new things or hidden things. And also it was about manipulative, that you actually could change things. By figuring out something about nature, you could then manipulate it and achieve change in some way. And here you have a number of these science, magic of course, which is about exploiting the powers in nature, not just observing, not just contemplating, but actually exploiting, trying to create change in the world through finding out about this hidden association. Astrology, demonology, alchemy, and so on. We talked a bit about alchemy last time. Also these sort of ways of trying to figure out how things were working, and also through this change to manipulate things. Kabbalism, which was this idea that sort of words had numerical values and occult values. So that basically then, especially if you had sort of the Bible, for instance, you can read that then the idea that every word in the Bible had some, could be given a number. And then by sort of these numbers, if you can calculate among them, then you could find out sort of hidden meanings there. That was the idea about this Kabbalah. And natural magic. And natural magic is interesting. It's because that's what we today might be described as technology in many ways. Or the thing sort of to demonstrate things. I mean, I talked last time about Hero of Alexandria, which in some ways, in this, if he was living in this time, he would be considered a natural magician in that sense. He achieved sort of wondrous devices that created fantastic effects of various kinds. And once again, also this is about natural magic. It was about finding new ways of doing things. So even though most of us today, I mean, sure, there are many that still do believe in astrology and so on, I believe that that works. But I think many of us would say that, well, this is pseudoscience, it doesn't work and so on. Yes, I think I would agree that, but that's not the important point. The important point was that this time, this was seen as working. This was seen as sort of, not everyone, of course, but a large part of the population, even though sort of Christians and religious people, they also believed that magic worked. They believed that astrology worked and so on. So therefore, in many ways, this was not seen as something else. This was seen as a part of sort of knowledge, knowledge traditions. And many, many, many science, what we today would consider science, was also very much influenced or maybe even practiced this. I'm going to talk about Newton later, and he was an alchemist. He spent a large part of his time sort of working on alchemy. He wrote about a million words on alchemy. And so he believed very much in many of these things, and he is not the only one for sure. Okay, and also at the same time, we also have this, what can be described as the new humanism. From the 15th century, starting in Italian universities, you have a sort of a humanistic education growing up, and suddenly they're studying sort of ancient texts and studying sort of literature and so on, and history and so on. And then at that time, humanistic education started to sort of, in some ways, becoming valuable, at least be seen as valuable, also not just for sort of for priests and theologians, but also for creating politicians and statesmen. It was seen that by studying through a humanistic education, you would understand better how the world works, or at least how to manipulate, maybe, or sort of how to operate in society, how to behave towards other people, so that you could sort of achieve what you were intended to achieve. And then from the 16th century, you also have a number of philosophers that trained in humanistic studies. And so this value of humanism was pervading scholarship. And the one important part of this humanism is about the Renaissance. And the idea about the Renaissance is basically that you can recover, sort of revive old, ancient knowledge, Greek, old Greek knowledge, the knowledge of the Greeks and the Romans, and there was the times before that. Actually, we have lost, but the idea was that we had, that Europe in this case, the West, had lost a large part of knowledge that was sort of forgotten about, which was true in many ways. And now we could sort of recover that and revive that. And that was sort of part of this new humanism. But then also comes, sort of about this time, there also comes a problem for scholasticism. And that's the problem of new things. Suddenly, we sort of see things that are new, that haven't been there before, especially in the heavens, where everything should be unchangeable. The supernovas and comets are things that sort of people start to sort of write about and observe. And then, of course, Columbus' so-called discovery of the New World in 1492 is also a new thing. So this was something that was not known. There was suddenly a new place, a new sort of part of the world with a number of new things, new plants, new animals that hadn't been seen before. So suddenly that was a challenge to a lot of this sort of established science in that sense. So suddenly had all these new things which shouldn't be there in a way, because we knew what was out there. The world was known. And here you see an example of this. What you see here is a from the 1580s, a Flemish artist, and he sort of made this image calling New Discoveries, Nova Reperta. And what he's putting here in 1580, what he's putting here as these new discoveries are different of these, many of these new things. First he here had the compass, which was, came from China, the New World, what we talked about. And then also a plant, a specific plant that was seen as be a cure for syphilis, was thought at this time. We have the printing press, developed by Gutenberg, of course, in the 1540s. We have a mechanical clock, and you also have alchemy, or you have distillation equipment. Many of these come from the Arabic world, especially. So many of these things are coming from other parts of Europe, also. That's why they are new in this sense. The stirrup, this is a saddle with a stirrup, and then you have a cannon, mechanical cannon. So it was also new things, and especially connected to this was about gunpowder, which of course had been known by the Chinese for a millennia or so, but now coming to Europe during this period. And then the last part is, what is the last part? That's a good one. Oh yeah. And silkworms connected to mulberry tree. Because silkworms was of course also coming from China. China had for a long time producing silk, but Europe did not know how that silk was produced until one discovered that sort of the silk came from silkworms that was spinning their cocoons, and then the material from the cocoons was then used to make the silk. But this was not discovered, of course, because it had been known for a long time, but the Europeans discovered how that was happening, how that was coming about at this time. So here you see, what you see here is basically a person living in the 1580s realizing that this is a new time we're living here. There's a lot of number of new things happening here. As I say, new discoveries. And he saw this as sort of, there was many people saw themselves as living in a time of great change, with a lot of new things. And part of that, of course, was also the discoveries of science. In 1543, many consider 1543 to be sort of the starting year of the scientific revolution. And why they consider the 1543 to be the starting year is because two major important work was published that year. The first one, Andreas Vesalius, De Humanis Corporis Fabrica, on the fabric of the human body, which in many ways we see as sort of laying the foundation of anatomy as some kind of systematic discipline. Vesalius was a military surgeon, a military doctor, and it's thought also that he was very sort of, a large part of sort of his discoveries also come from that he was sort of, dissecting bodies. And also for the first time here, he actually showed a number of pictures of these bodies, sort of dissecting bodies. So that was new also, and it was not just new what he said, but also the way he presented these things. But this was like a major work that was sort of got sort of, you can say it was a blockbuster of its day. Thanks to this work, he actually got a, thanks to this book, he got to work as sort of a court magician to a German count. And then, sort of, and also he produced a more sort of simplified version. So this was a huge success. And suddenly sort of people started to see how you looked inside bodies. You could start to think about how the bodies work. Of course, there'd been medicine for a long time. Galen especially, which was one of these ancient doctors in Greek. And also Vesalius built a lot of what he said on Galen, but he also sort of did new things. He also showed things and he actually came up also discovering new things and new diseases, among other things. So that's one of the central work. And then the other one is Copernicus' work, De Revolutionis Nubis, Orbium Celestium, on the revolutions of the heavenly spheres, which to many, of course, sort of lays the foundation of a new way of looking at, not just the world, but looking at the universe, and also in some ways setting the foundation of what then later on becomes sort of modern physics. Okay, but let's then take a little bit look at, so that we're talking here about sort of science and I mentioned natural philosophy and so on. So we have a lot of number of sort of terms for this thing that we today call science or natural science. But at this time, what we today would describe as science was known as natural philosophy. The study of natural bodies as such and of the phenomena connected with them, physical science, physics. This is from Oxford English Dictionary, how it defines it. And this is one of the first mentionings of this from the 15th century, 1456. And then science, if you just take a look at the word of science, then it's interesting to see the changes of the word of science here. I already mentioned that there was sort of a science, Aristotelian science. But in the beginning, science was knowledge acquired by study, acquaintance with or mastery of any department of learning. So knowledge, what we today would describe as knowledge, I guess, or educated knowledge, doesn't say anything about the natural world, so any kind of knowledge. But then some changes coming, and in the 18th century, we have sort of illustrating one of these changes, how the way we look at science. A branch of study which is concerned either with a connected body of demonstrated truths or within the observed facts systematically classified and more or less corrugated by being brought under the general laws, and which include trustworthy methods for the discovery of new truth, which is within its own domain. So this is important. Trustworthy methods for the discovery of new truth. Once again, this is new. This was not, once again, part of what the old Aristotelian science was about. It's not about discovering new truths. It was just to show how, with the knowledge we knew, how things were. But this is about new truth, coming from the 18th century onwards. And at least then it's starting to be used, although in printing this way. And then from the 19th century onwards, synonymous with natural and physical science, and thus restricted to those branches of study that relate to the phenomena of the material universe and their laws, sometimes with implied exclusion of pure mathematics. So this is in many ways, of course, even though we have, of course, sort of economic science, social science, humanistic science, in some ways you can say, today we have gone back here to sort of the first definition. Science is used for all systematic kinds of knowledge that are systematic and often based on some kind of research. But even though often when science is used, it's often this meaning, I mean, sort of basically physics, chemistry, maybe mathematics, engineering science, that's a medical science. That's generally what I think in English when you're using the term science, that's often what it's meant. And then, to jump ahead of time also, we have also for the first time a term for this person, this doing this new thing, scientist. Quote from William Whewell, a mathematician, 1840. We need very much a name to describe the cultivator of science in general. I should incline to call him a scientist. And it was not just him that was inclined to that, because many sort of followed Whewell and then sort of used this new term. So basically from the 19th century onwards, we talk about scientists. Of course, there had been scientists before that, but then they were known as natural philosophers. That was sort of generally how they were known before this time. Okay. So this is a little bit sort of the road we're now gonna join. So this is roughly sort of the scientific revolution. Starting in 1500, we have the scientific renaissance, and then 1596-50, you have the critical period of scientific revolution, 1657-04, you have the consensus consolidation period, and then in 1704, you have the end of the first scientific revolution. It's the end because that's when Newton published his work, Optics, and that's considered to be sort of the end point of scientific revolution. As I said already, we had a number of established sort of knowledge traditions: scholastic Aristotelianism, humanism, Hermetic tradition, magical and chemical system. By sort of the 16th century, by 1500 or so, this was the established knowledge tradition. This was what knowledge was about at that time, was systematic knowledge. Well, yeah, somewhat systematic knowledge. But then so we see a number of what is this new science about then? What is the scientific revolution about? Well, it's about emerging new knowledge traditions within natural philosophies. Is it towards a new mathematical philosophy with examples of mathematicians or mathematical natural philosophers such as Copernicus and Kepler? It's also towards a new empirical philosophy, basically meaning that you should actually look, you should sort of, not just sort of using mathematics and other things, but also you should look and be an empiricist, basically. Vesalius, Paracelsianism, Agricola, all of these are sort of scientists during this period that were sort of empiricists, we would say. They were basing their knowledge on observation. And somewhat later on also experiments. But then also towards a new utilitarian philosophy. Basically, philosophy that should be used for other purposes than just sort of explaining things, that should actually be used for more practical purposes. Also known as sometimes from the 17th century as Baconism, named after Francis Bacon. And then you also have other people like Agricola and Paracelsus. Also, they was trying to use this knowledge to change things, to affect things, to help the state with things, to help sort of more practical applications, such as mining and so on. And then also last, towards a new mechanistic philosophy, with Galileo and Descartes, who basically the world is operating according to mechanical principles in some ways, law-bound principles, things that we can sort of figure out and sort of discover and then utilize. So these are sort of what the scientific revolution is about. These are the main changes that happens in this time. Mathematization, empiricism, utilitarianism, and mechanism, you can say. So these are the overall sort of the big changes from the state of the art at this time. As I said, part of this was about, I talked about humanistic renaissance. There was the idea that you should go back to the ancient times and figure out sort of what they recover this lost knowledge. But this was not just for humanism. This idea, this Renaissance idea, actually also moves into natural philosophy. And you have, starting with sort of in the 1460s, with what's been considered to be the central Renaissance scientist, Regiomontanus, or Johannes Müller, as was his real name, so to speak, of Königsberg, working at the University of Vienna. And he was interested in astronomy, and he then revived and corrected Ptolemy's, ancient astronomer, his astronomical models and his astronomical tables. And through this, then, he transferred this idea of the humanistic revival to the natural sciences, or to natural philosophy, and in this case, to the mathematical sciences. So that's one example. They also have in other areas, like in medicine and the mathematics also, you have similar kind of sort of attempts to revive old science. And once again, the point is here, it's still not seen so much as doing something new. It's sort of about recovering, reviving the old, the lost knowledge, maybe correcting it slightly somewhat, but not sort of dramatically new. You're building on the old system that's already existing there. Vesalius, I already mentioned, at the University of Padua, he was sort of correcting and denouncing Galen, but not overthrowing his system. Even he was demonstrating dissection to students and so on. And even though he found some new illnesses like syphilis and suffocating diphtheria. But overall, this was more about sort of recovering Galen's knowledge and correcting it somewhat. And then you also have in mathematics, even though you have some revivalist mathematics. Basically with ideas and sort of then also to recover but equal ancient mathematics, but even also somewhat sort of slightly surpassed. Now you see also sort of the ideas that actually to go somewhat further, but still within the same system, the existing system. It's not about creating a new system really. But that happens, the new system, to create a new system, to create a revolutionary system, that first happens within astronomy. When you have going from revivalist to revolutionary science. With, as I already mentioned, Nicolaus Copernicus, when he in 1543 publishes the Revolutionaries. And starting then by improving on Ptolemy, but then actually he goes ahead, he goes sort of further than Ptolemy. And likewise then also later on also the same sort of, in physics also you see revolutionary activities, which is starting off from restoring Archimedean mechanics. This is also happening in Italy, northern Italy. But then, with Galileo, it's also about sort of overthrowing, you can say, Archimedean mechanics, or at least coming up with new things, and radically new things. And in 1637, Galileo claimed that he invented something new that the ancients had not possessed. That he had sort of come up with something radically new that the ancients had not possessed. So what you see here is basically, once again, starting off, inspired by what's happening in humanistic sciences, humanism in this time, and then this idea about Renaissance ideas and transferred on to the natural philosophy, and then later on also that sort of actually not just about sort of Renaissance and revival, it's actually also then going about to about revolution, to create new things, new sciences. And just to illustrate, to show here, sort of like, there was not, I mean, this is not just something that we historians afterwards looking back and saying, oh, look here, they're doing all these new things and so on. I mean, yeah, there's a 17th revolution going on, starting here. This is actually seen also in its time that there was something new happening here. So this is, and that just to illustrate that, here we have a number of the books published by these new scientists in this time, and many of these books just have this new in the title. Johannes Kepler published New Astronomy in 1609. Francis Bacon, a new instrument, a new method. Bacon also published New Atlantis. Galileo, discourse demonstrated concerning two new sciences. One of them is strength of materials. Boyle, new experiments. Otto von Guericke, new Magdeburg experiments, so on and so forth. I mean, here's a quote also from Francis Bacon, from his new instrument, Novum Organum. We have as yet no natural philosophy that is pure. All is tainted and corrupted. So what we see here now is sort of a very clear sort of view that actually the existing scholastic Aristotelians, the existing sort of natural philosophy is faulty. It doesn't work. It's, as he's saying here, it's not pure. It's tainted. It's corrupted. So we started to see here a view basically, that's why we call this a revolution. A more revolutionary view. They're saying that this old system doesn't work. It doesn't sort of, it doesn't produce, doesn't explain the world in that sense. But of course, they are still at this point a minority. They are not the majority. I mean, overall, this is the dominant view. The dominant view is still the dominant view. And the dominant view is scholasticism, Aristotelianism. So here we see one of these revolutionary, I call him reluctant revolutionary, because he was Copernicus, he was in many ways sort of, even though he was a revolution, came up with revolutionary things, he was sort of struggling with that, because he was also part of the existing dominant system. He was part of the church, he was working as a cleric. But his background is that in 1473 he was born in Thorn, present-day Poland. He was a Prussian, Polish merchant son, is adopted by a scholar, an uncle was a bishop of Ermland, and then he was preparing for an ecclesiastical career, a career within the church. And he studied in a cathedral school in Wroclaw. And then in 1491, he went to the University of Krakow where he studied mathematics, astronomy, astrology, and he lectured on Tubach, the new theories of the planets. So once again, now it's starting to see sort of there are some newness coming here. And then, which was that time was a center for humanistic learning. So there you have this idea about the humanistic renaissance and so on. Then, after a couple of years, he moves on to the University of Bologna where he studied canon laws, and now he's sort of switching more towards sort of his future professional career, what he thinks is going to be a future professional career. Canon and civil law. He becomes an assistant professor of astronomy and made a number of observations. And he actually then sort of also lectured on mathematics. And then, after a couple of years, then he moves on to another university where he studied law, medicine, learned Greek, and was once again influenced by this radical humanism. And then his last university, he went to the University of Ferrara, where he took a degree in canonical law. And after that, then he leaves university and starts working for the church as an administrator, as a bureaucrat, canonical administrator. He was physician to his bishop, his uncle, the bishop. And then but also at the same time, he was also continuing sort of the work that he's sort of been doing at these universities and doing astronomical observations only sort of his spare time. And then finally, he published this Revolution Ubis, and it's actually published on his deathbed. He's sort of been given the copy when he's lying there on his deathbed, and he dies a couple of days, I think, or maybe a week or so, after he's been given the first copy of his magnum opus. And what he did here, what the central thing about Copernicus, that he was overthrowing the classical universe. Up until, as I said already, so this was the dominant view of the universe, the Ptolemaic system. Earth was in the center, the planets and stars were connected to spheres and were circling around the Earth. But it was known that it was not good, this system. Well, it was good, but it wasn't perfect, in the sense because there was a number of anomalies that couldn't really be explained. And one was there was an apparent retrogression of Mars, Jupiter, and Saturn. And by that means, basically, if you look on the sky and you follow Mars, for instance, then you would see it was going in this, but then it was actually going backwards and then going like this. But how could that happen? Because in the skies, everything should be perfect circular motions. That was known. That was the way it was. Everyone knew that. So how could... So, obviously it wasn't, but if you know that this is the case, then you have to try to find a solution to this within that system. So basically, and this is sort of why we know this, because this is why this is an apparent sort of retrogression. It's not an actual retrogression, of course. I mean, the planets are going in circular spheres or elliptical spheres, as we know now. So this is how it actually is, but this is how it looks there. And so another also problem. So there's a variation in brightness of Mars, for instance. And once again, there shouldn't be any changes there. I mean, everything in the skies are unchangeable. And there was also an apparent variation in the size of the moon. So there were some problems with this system. But, as I said, if you know that everything is moving in perfect circles, then you have to explain it according to perfect circular motions. They come up with a number of modification of this to explain how this apparent retrogression actually came from circular motions. One was that there was sort of extended, that Earth is somewhat displaced from the circle center. Another one was that it was epicyclic. Basically, it was moving in a circle, but then it was moving in another circle on the circle, and then you actually could add the number of circles on the circle. So you basically have this number of epicenters there. So that would, and basically, if you have enough of these circles, epicenters, then you could get any kind of sort of motion there. But still, it works according to the perfect circular motions. And then it was also that in the equant point, that basically that basically it's a uniform circular motion, but it's from a different point than from the center. If you view from this point, then you would find the perfect circular motion. So basically, what this illustrates is sort of like what we still see today, of course. I mean, if you know how the theory works and how it is, then of course you are using that model to explain what this is. You're trying to figure out, you're trying to use the model, the theory you know, to explain the things. And of course that's difficult if there is a totally different system than what you have been learning. So this was the problem, but there was some attempts to come up with an explanation to this. But Copernicus then actually found out, no, he could come up with a way of looking a different way, and that was to place not Earth in the center, but place the Sun in the center. That's of course a radical change in this. So it was a new center of the universe, a heliocentric universe, where the Sun is in the center. Here's a quote from Copernicus. It says, "In the center of all rests the Sun, for who would place this lamp of a very beautiful temple in another better place than this from which it can illuminate everything at the same time? As a matter of fact, not unhappily do some call it the lantern, others the mind, and still others the pilot of the world." Trismegistus, this is Hermes Trismegistus, the one sort of the Hermeticism mentioned before, calls it the visible god, Sophocles Electra, that which gazes upon all things, and so the sun, as if resting on a kingly throne, governs the family of stars which wheel around. So this is not something we really see much in scientific texts today, of course, this kind of language. This also shows very much the influence of the humanism here, and sort of what kind of references he gives. It's not, but he's also giving references to Ptolemy and others, but also giving references to Hermes Trismegistus and Sophocles, I mean, which is of course part of this new Hermes of the new knowledge tradition, and Sophocles of course about this ancient revival of humanistic learning. So that's one central point, that is a new center of the sun. And then of course you have a moving Earth, and then not just that it's moving around the sun, it also shows that the Earth is actually moving in three different ways. It has annual motion around the sun, but then also have a daily rotation around its own axis, as we all know, of course, and then the precession, it's a daily wobble, sort of that is actually slightly off the axis of rotation. And all of this, of course, was radical. And this was something that sort of many couldn't believe in, wouldn't want to believe in. It went against sort of accept the way the world is. So it took a long time sort of before the Copernicanism spread at this time. 1543, about 400, 500 copies of the Rubus Nubis was published at that time. But there was soon also coming up in the second and then also the third edition. But there was a number of scientific objections to this. Because, I mean, basically arguing that this wouldn't work, I mean, because things would thrown off with the land off their course. It was basically you could figure out a number of sort of objections why this theory couldn't work. Birds would fly off if they took part in Earth motion and so on. And also no stereo parallax observed. So there's a number of things that you could figure out that didn't work in that sense. But even more important was the religious objections. From the Bible, for instance, it says in the book of Joshua, "Sun, stand thou still," which of course meant that sort of the sun was moving, not the earth. Sun, stand still. So basically, the Bible has told us that there was the sun moving, not the earth. But then gradually also there's some kind of what we describe as relative acceptance, in the sense that first it was being interpreted as, well, maybe we can interpret this as a mathematical hypothesis or a model. It's a calculation model. Yes, this is not how it is, but the model works to calculate. It works to calculate this objection. So astronomers accepted this as sort of as a calculation device, because they realized that using this model, you could actually come up with a better the result fitted better than before. And then also gradually some actually also takes on this theory more and more. But basically about 1600, you can say there was only about 10 Copernicans in that time, 10 people or so that believed in Copernicus, they believed in his sort of model. But then a number of things comes up that sort of seems to support this. In 1572, you see a new star, supernova, being discovered. And then the problem with this is that it looks like it might be beyond the moon's orbit. And once again, sort of, you have these sort of spheres, you have these sort of crystalline spheres, and how could then things sort of come up with this? And how could, even more importantly, when you have observational comets and basically things that are coming from one part beyond the moon and going in front of the moon, how is that possible if there are crystalline spheres there? That wouldn't work then. So, and then sort of a compromise with this is called the Tychonic system, which was a system developed by Tycho Brahe, where Earth is in the center, but all planets are then around the sun. So there's sort of, it's a modification of it's somewhere in between, a compromise between these two systems. But then also have Kepler coming up in 69, when he is one of these 10, you can say, Copernicans. He's a follower, and he then sort of, what he's doing, he's modifying Copernicus by not circular, perfect circular movements, but elliptical revolutions, elliptical circles. And then in 1610 you have Galileo's and his Starry Messenger, where they basically show that Jupiter's moons and they have centers. You have sunspots, the sun has spots on it, so basically the sun is not perfect as it should be. So you have a number of things that are sort of showing that actually this is something new. Because the point about Jupiter's moon is basically show that there was another center of motion there. That basically, that if the moons are circling around Jupiter, then the Earth cannot be in the center of all motion. Because there's another center of motion there. So once again, this system don't work. The old system don't work. And then you can say by 1660, so the sort of the Copernican worldview is generally accepted. Okay, as I said, one of the first sort of these areas where there sort of started to be some radical new revolutionary change was within astronomy and to some degree physics. Another area where sort of also happening a number of dramatic changes in this period is also in mathematics. But basically before this, you can say mathematics may be seen as a second-class science within the Aristotelian system. Second-class compared to sort of Aristotelian physics. Because science, like physics in the Aristotelian system, was about explaining things, explaining the essence of things, how things, why the causes of things, where things were moving, things were changing. And it's about demonstrate conclusions from sort of these different causes that were guiding things. While mathematics, in this sense, was more about describing things. It was not about sort of explaining, it was about describing things. And there were some areas within mathematics known as mixed mathematics, in astronomy and music, where they actually sort of then some quantities of something were measured. So that was sort of seen as somewhat more sort of closer to science than in other areas. But basically, the main problem was that the mathematics was seen as restricted to superficial properties, not about the essence of things, but just sort of about sort of superficial things. Quantities is not, once again, not about the essence of things. And mathematical measurements were purely then sort of descriptive, not sort of explanatory in that sense. So, and also the problem with mathematics was that mathematical objects was not real things, I mean, in a sense. Numbers and things, I mean, sort of and figures, they were not real, they were just sort of made up things in that sense. So they lacked sort of true essences in that sense, like different from material matters in that sense. But then it's sort of changing that some Aristotelians are actually advocating a different view about mathematics. Actually, they sort of should upgrade it in some way, that you should actually take that more seriously, that you should elevate the study of mathematics. And part of these arguments was practical, sort of that. Actually, that pedagogy there was a harm in pedagogy of denigrating mathematics. I mean, logic and so on was very important, but also arguing that mathematics was important for the training, for education. And then it's also about also referring back to ancient authority. And once again, this is sort of what in the scholastic system, you refer back to ancient authority. You refer to authority, those that have sort of told us how things were, like Aristotle, which was the key sort of knower of things. So and also Aristotle had actually himself then sort of accorded math equal cognitive status, but that had been lost sort of on the way. So that was the argument that actually mathematics should be given more sort of focus, more attention. And then from the 1600s onwards, then there becomes sort of a number of sort of continue working on mathematics and especially about mathematical demonstrations. And then that is then gradually leading towards what we today would describe as mathematical physics. That's sort of the starting points towards a mathematical physics. And one of these mathematical physicists, one of those sort of very much focused on mathematics, Copernicus had not been that much focused on mathematics. He would be more focused on sort of trying to explain the system. Sure, he was using data to sort of fit his observations and so on, but he was not very much a mathematician in that sense. But Kepler, he was a mathematician. And he's also one of these, once again, one of these people inspired by these new forms of the more occult forms of knowledge. And he was trying to explain God's universe through mathematics because he was very inspired by this Platonism, but also this called Pythagorean mysticism. And Pythagoras was an ancient mathematician, and he believed that sort of that it was the whole numbers was ruling the world, or everything could be sort of was had these numbers. There was a number mystery to that, and he believed that everything was guided by mathematical relationship. And Kepler then could figure out basically using this called Platonic solids, the cube, the sphere, all these sort of different solids. He could then use and coming up with. It could connect them to the planetary motions. He found a relationship there. That they basically, you could argue, instead of these sort of spheres, they could be separated by Platonic solid. And that gave sort of about a 5% error from the observer there. But so that was not too bad. It was much better than the previous system there. And then 1600, he then went and worked for the, then one of the leading astronomers, Tycho Brahe in Denmark, or present-day Sweden, even though he had then left Denmark and actually moved to Prague, where he'd been employed as a court astronomer. But then, so he works there with Brahe for about a year or so, and then Brahe dies. But then Kepler could acquire his data. So, and Brahe had, while he was still working in Sweden, he had his own sort of, you can almost call it big science laboratory, big science astronomy, where a number of people sort of observing and taking data of sort of the skies and the planetary movements of the sky. Basically, he was very wealthy. He was an aristocrat. He had a large amount of money. He was also large support by the Danish king. So he had the fortune to support his own research program there. Anyway, with this very good data that Brahe had collected for numbers of years, then he could use this data to fit to his model. And in 1609 he published Astronomia Nova, new astronomy, once again all these new things, where he sort of then presents two mathematical laws of planetary motion. And this is based once again about the elliptic, that actually the planets are not moving in perfect circles, they're moving in ellipses. And he also then talks about that there was a physical cause of this planetary motion. There was actually some sort of attraction there. So this is sort of the birth of a new physical mathematical field, so-called celestial mechanics. And once again, sort of, he is one of these few Copernicans of the day. But there was also some other Copernicans. And in 1597, while he was actually, before he went to Prague, he had already published some works then, he got a letter from another private Copernican. And I'm going to read that letter here. I indeed congratulate myself on having an associate in the study of truth, who is a friend of truth. For it is a misery that so few exist to pursue the truth and do not pervert philosophical reason. I adopted the teaching of Copernicus many years ago, and this point of view enables me to explain many phenomena of nature which certainly remain inexplicable according to the more current hypothesis. I have written many arguments in support of him and the refutation of the opposite view, which, however, so far, I have not dared to bring into the public light, frightened by the fate of Copernicus himself, our teacher, who, though he acquired immortal fame with some, is yet to remain to an infinite number of others, for such is the number of fools, an object of ridicule and derision. I would certainly dare to publish my reflections at once, if more people like you existed, as they don't, I shall refrain from doing so. And the person that sent this letter was this person, Galileo Galilei. He was, as I said, he was another one of these secret Copernicans, the one that sort of had actually sort of been convinced about the Copernican worldview. And he wrote this letter then to Kepler to sort of convey that Kepler was not alone in this endeavor. And of course, as we all know, Galileo Galilei was one of the central figures of the scientific revolution. I started off by showing his finger then that's preserved today in the Museum of Science in Florence. And here's very shortly sort of his career. And this career was very much a career in mathematics. He was born as son of a musician and musical theorist, which also got mixed mathematics. Music was one of these areas, it's called mixed mathematics, where mathematics was sort of seen as an important part of the practice. In 1580, he became a student at the University of Pisa, where he studied medicine, although he disliked all the dogmatism of medicine, so then he sort of more shifted towards mathematics, although he left without a degree. But then, in 1589, became a lecturer in mathematics in Pisa. And then later on in 1590, he also became a professor of mathematics in Padua. And then is when he published one of his first major work, The Starry Messenger, which is when sort of he's presenting some of his work on astronomy at that time. And thanks to his publishing of Starry Messenger, he actually gets, because he dedicates this book to the Grand Duke of Tuscany, and through this dedication then gets actually a job by the Grand Duke. He was came so flattered by this that he then employs him as court philosopher and mathematician. And then it's during this time when he's court philosopher and mathematician that he published Dialogue Concerning the Two Principal Systems of the World, which is one of course one of his major works. And this is also the work that has, leads him to be condemned by the church in Rome, because what he's saying is going against the dogma, the scholastic Aristotelian dogma, going against the Bible, like both Copernicus and also Kepler went against the dogma. And then, so in 1633, he's condemned by the church and then actually been given house arrest for the rest of his life, more or less. And then, but while in house arrest, he also published a discourse concerning the two new sciences, where he also works and presents very much sort of the experimental method. And then in 1642, he dies in France. So I want to take a little bit more look about Galileo, especially about his mathematics, because once again, there's many, many interesting things about Galileo. But one that at least I think is interesting is that in many ways he can be described as a mathematical engineer or a practical mathematician. He had a long life occupation with engineering problems. I mean, actually was working on pumps and fortifications and regulation of rivers. I mean, often when you hear about Galileo, of course, you think about him as sort of the scholar, the physicist, the one, the professor, the one that sort of observing the skies, but sort of walking around thinking about all these sort of grand thoughts. But actually was also very much involved in very practical problems. When he was a student in Pisa, he then was become, once again, he's also one of these sort of influenced by this new Renaissance. Then the Renaissance also been entering mathematics. He was, when he was a student in Pisa, was working with these revivalist Renaissance mathematicians. And he was trained by in mathematics by a Renaissance engineer, one of these sort of engineers, mathematicians that sort of believed in the idea of sort of to recover this lost mathematical knowledge. And then later also when he lectured in Padua, then he actually worked on what can be described as commercial mathematics, in the sense that he gave lectures on fortification, surveying, mechanics, optics, and also set up his own workshop for mathematical instruments. And he actually even applied for a Venetian patent on a water racing device. So he was very much also involved in very practical problems, issues. And then, when, as I said, he became a courtier, he became a court philosopher to the Duke of Tuscany. He then also worked on political mathematics, in the sense that he was suggesting supervision, he was supervising suggestions for engineering projects for the Duke. He was then helping out the Duke sort of to with his both military but also sort of his large sort of civil works projects. So he was very much sort of helping out the political powers of the day, very much sort of an applied practical mathematician. And in that sense, sort of a lot of Galileo's life was very focused on sort of had a number of varied activities as an inventor. One historian that said that one has to imagine that every one of Galileo's discoveries in physics and astronomy is closely connected with any instrument that was either invented or modified in a special way by him. And of course, one of these instruments are the telescope that we know of from before. Yes, okay, good. But of course, he was not just an engineer, a mathematician. He was also a physicist, a mathematical physicist, or maybe a philosophical mathematician. And one of his main points about Galileo's work is that he came up with sort of a mathematical philosophy of motion, what we today describe as dynamics. And I'm sure all of you have been studying, if you study mechanics, and of course dynamics is one of these areas that you are all studying, which is basically about the mathematical account of natural or forced motion, an account of how we can sort of describe motion of bodies, of things, through mathematics. And that was a central topic of Aristotelian physics. And he's publishing two works, central important works, in 1590 and in 1638. First one is De Motu on motion, and the second one is Discourse on demonstrating regarding two new sciences. Well, in the first one on De Motu, he's then sort of focusing on natural motion. A body falls because it seeks its proper place, and so on, that we all heard about. But he's then sort of doing experiments. And of course, this is the famous Leaning Tower of Pisa, which Galileo supposedly used for his experiments, dropping falling bodies from the tower and measuring the time. So he was doing experimentation to demonstrate the truth or claim the experience. What he's doing here is doing experimentation, and this is one of the new things, that actually doing experiments. He's not just sort of trusting in discourse and arguing and demonstrating. He's actually doing practical experiments. He's manipulating nature to test sort of laws. Even though also it's not just sort of actual experiments, it's also thought experiments. I mean, in his book, he's sort of describing thought experiments, but we also know that he was actually doing actual experiments also. But then also in 1638, another of his central work is also then doing sort of what is launching two, what he described as two new sciences, which is the strength of materials and as well classical mechanics. And of course, once again here, he's then sort of launching a new way of a new mathematical way of describing the world, not just the heavens, but what's happening on Earth, sort of the movements on Earth. I mean, Copernicus and Kepler, they together sort of revolutionized what's happening in the heavens. And of course, Galileo also continued along this work, but he is also focusing on sort of changing the Aristotelian physics on the Earth, the movements of things on Earth. So he then transforming lowly mechanics into a physics paradigm in that sense. Once again, influenced by this humanist revival or Aristotelian mechanical tradition, once again, influenced by these Renaissance engineers that was interested in theoretical questions. But what he did then is was connecting these the culture of practitioners, educated engineers. He was using, you can say, the practical culture of engineers, or practical engineers, was then influencing actually also the way of how physics, how this new science was then also operating in its time. So both, there's a number of influences. I mean, every scientist are not operating in the context of sort of previous thoughts and ongoing thoughts and activities. And what we see here is sort of that Galileo is very much also, like any other scientist, a sort of a product of his time and a product of the history of its time here. And in this sense, the Renaissance and also the sort of the practical culture of the places that he was working on in Italy. Okay, so now sort of then we enter sort of the critical period of the scientific revolution, where the problem is that now we have sort of this Galileo's work and we have the Kepler's and Copernicus work that have sort of launched some new ways, some revolutionary ways of seeing things. The problem now is to find a more sort of mathematical and operational natural knowledge. This is sort of the path that sort of Galileo has set us on. And you can say the pragmatic solution was that to be content with the results and just leaving aside useless quests. Just sort of in some ways, just keep on sort of working small local solutions, practical solutions. I mean, just continue within the scholastic system, you can say, but then sort of having all these different ways, new ways of doing things. That was so more or less sort of modify or continue as usual with the overall big system. In a sense, accepting the scholastic worldview, but still sort of operate within these specific things. The other way would be to actually try to do a new system, to achieve some a new revolutionary radical system, to basically abolish the old Aristotelian system. But this, up until this point, there have been sort of parts of the Aristotelian system have been sort of Kepler and Copernicus and also Galileo have abolished parts of it, but they haven't sort of, the whole system, the big system is still there in place. But then the challenge here is then to try to come up with a system to construct a world that only operates according to mechanical principle, mechanistic principle. And the person that starts doing this is Descartes. He's launching a sort of a natural philosophy called known as Cartesianism. And that became sort of the dominant natural philosophy until the 18th century. But the interesting thing with this is that today, when you read about sort of basically nothing really of this sort of natural philosophy is still with us in science. It's there about sort of the method in a way and sort of the discourse, but not any of the sort of the discoveries or whatever you want to call it, or theories of Descartes, because they don't work today. They don't work as physics. They don't work as natural science. So its theory don't agree with observations. But it was very important. But up until the 18th century, that was considered to be a system that was plausible, that was believed by many. But then Newton and others came and sort of showed that this system didn't work. But the point is, but the important part of this is that it was, even though we don't sort of, we have sort of thrown away all of its sort of the scientific result, if you'd like that, or scientific theories, it still laid a foundation for modern science. Because it's provided a total system to challenge Aristotelians. It's basically showed that it was possible to come up with another system that was as plausible, more plausible than Aristotelianism. So its big sort of contribution to modern science is that it basically showed that, no, you can have another way of looking at the world that work in that sense. Even though today we know it doesn't work, but it worked, it explained things. It helped to explain things then. And it's also, he also sort of provided a philosophical attitude towards development of new theories. that everything could be explained by science. Everything could be explained by science. So basically, because he dares, you can say, to take this big view and look for a big system that sort of encompass everything, like the Aristotelian system. And so but it's different. It's totally, radically different. And it's not Aristotelian. It's not a modification of Aristotelian. It's something else. So that is sort of his big, that is Descartes' big contribution to modern science. But however, there was also it was a problem of explanation, not investigation. I mean, Descartes started from sort of reasoning from first principle. He started to reason, came up with sort of how can things be, and start from, and then reasoning how things should be, not actually investigating sort of through empiricism and through observations. I mean, of course, he had observed things in the world before, but it was not an experimental program in that sense. But even though, sort of, as I said, we don't believe in his science anymore. I mean, today, if you go to university and study Descartes, you study him for his philosophy primarily, or maybe for a sort of discussion about how sort of reason and logic in that sense. But you don't study him for his natural science. He's also had an interesting background. He was studied at Jesuit College, he got a degree in law, and then was working as a military in the Dutch army for a number of years. And then, before he returned to France, he at that point were bold enough to decide that he should come up with a universal science. He should sort of challenge Aristotelianism. And he felt that the true knowledge, we have seen already that many of these people sort of said that this old system is not true, it doesn't work, with the new things you came up with truth. And he was similar in the sense that he felt that the true knowledge required a new system, a complete new system. And then sort of he moved on, left France and moved to the Netherlands, and then he actually ended up in Stockholm where he died of pneumonia. And that sometimes, being a Swede, Swedish historians of science often joke that one of the biggest contributions Sweden have made to the history of science is to kill Descartes by a cold. He was working with Dr. Queen Christina in the Royal Castle of Stockholm, and then he caught a cold and pneumonia, and then he died. So that's sort of the end of his life there. But the point is that once again, one of the key points of Descartes' life is he said that we can understand science with everything. There's no phenomenon in nature whose treatment has been omitted. Basically, he covered everything in his system. His system explained everything. Even though, as I say today, I mean, it explained everything, but to know today that it is not true. It doesn't work. But it didn't work. So he wrote a number of things in science: mathematics, optics, mechanics, and physiology. Discourse on method, that's one of the, I think, still sort of are reading today, especially focused on analytical geometry. But then also one of the important sort of things that he talked about is in the Passions of the Soul, the mind-body dualism, that we have sort of, there is a dualism between the mind and the body, even though Descartes thought that you can find actually this penetrary gland up there which connected the mind and the body, that it was sort of like a gateway through from the body to the mind, where they sort of, you could enter these two different spheres. And then he was working on principles of philosophy, and that explained everything in nature. And as we know today, of course, I mean, now we read it more for the philosophy, not for the natural philosophy. But once again, the important thing with Descartes, he was in search of an absolutely certain philosophical foundation for a new science. And this is sort of one of the big contributions to this work. And he was attempting to replace Aristotle as the master of natural philosophy. And that's the one important thing here, because it's about replacement. It's not like the previous humanist revival. It's about emulating the ancient authority, sort of continuing along the age. It was to replace it, come up with something new, totally new system, a new scholasticism. He wanted basically to take Aristotle's place. He wanted to become the new Aristotle. He wanted to launch a new system that sort of could explain everything in the same way as Aristotle's system could. And also he wanted a science founded on certainty, something that things that we are certain about. His focus was on natural philosophy that felt was more superior to other ways of thinking about the world. And where he started was trying to, from ideas, was trying to find ideas that he sort of could, that you could be certain about, that he knew were true. And that's where this famous phrase, cogito ergo sum, comes from. I think, therefore I is. That was his starting point. You could doubt everything, you can doubt everything he said, except that you're thinking, and therefore you know that you are. So that was his starting point, and from there then he developed his philosophy. So philosophical skepticism was sort of his point, that you had to sort of question everything, but you have to reach something at one certain point. And for him, that was sort of, you think, therefore you are. So once again, Descartes is not someone that we think about as, many of us don't think about as a scientist nowadays, because we have sort of thrown away his system. His system showed itself not to be able to explain everything it claimed to be able to explain. But his attitude and his sort of attempt to launch a new system, to revolutionize the system, that is the big contribution to this. That he showed that it was possible to come up with another system, as we know now, equally faulty, but nevertheless another system that could explain things in the same way. Okay. So then following this, you come to the 1650s, and you come to the consensus and consolidation period of the scientific revolution, and then the end of the scientific revolution was 1704. So what you have by this time, you have then a new natural philosophy being developed, which is about going from recovering classical knowledge to developing novel, new intellectual progress. So this is the road we've been taking so far. We started off trying to sort of recover and revive ancient knowledge, but now instead what we are ending up with is actually trying to develop something new, not to recover something old, but develop something new, totally new, radically new. And also going from a contemplative to an active natural knowledge, going from actually to sort of thinking about, looking about towards nature, to actually try to manipulate it, try to operate it, first with experiments and so on, but then also later on with other things. And also you have then gradually more natural philosophy directed towards control of the world. Once again, going away from this sort of just observation and just standing aside and observing, but actually trying to control and manipulate the world. And also, what's coming gradually, we already saw that somewhat with Galileo Galilei working with sort of with the courts, statesmen and dukes and so on. We now see science as being sort of a new political and also public institution. Part of what science has seen, the sort of the benefits of science, seen that it sort of help to the state, serve the state in many ways. And that's also connected to this, that you have a utilitarian national, that knowledge should actually be used for something, it should be valuable. Not just valuable for itself to explain things, but actually valuable to be able to change things in the world. So in this sense, science then becomes associated with the welfare of the state. But also then what happens is it becomes mediated through new kinds of institutions. We also see at this time sort of see a number of new academies set up. Royal Society in England, one of the first academies, and Académie de France, Académie de Sciences in France, also these sort of new institutions, organizations set up to help support science, but also to guide science into new directions. And then at the end of the period, you have the Newtons that consolidated the work of Copernicus, Galileo, and Kepler. Okay. But still, even though at this time, there is one thing that's an unchanging feature of all this with science, and this is still this natural philosophy involved God in some way. This is still not an atheist science in that sense. Sure, it's about mechanistic principles and so on, you explain it according to mechanistic principles, but still, God is not thrown out of this system. Not, maybe he has sort of stepped back more or less, and sort of, he may be sort of the first mover and so on, that sort of steps back and let sort of the laws evolve over time. But still, at this time, more or less all of scientists are true believer, faithful believer, I mean, devoted sort of Christians, Galileo, Copernicus, Kepler, even though they had sort of also mysticism and so on inspired by that, they still would consider themselves, I mean, to be Christians. I mean, once again, Copernicus was working in the church. He was they were all sort of, in some way, sort of religious people, which of course goes today also with many scientists, still, of course, also religious people. But of course, today, God has left science in many ways. I mean, it's not there, but at this time, still, God is there in science. It hasn't left this area. So what's happening then there? So one of these new things that's happening there is that, once again, that science becomes a utilitarian philosophy. It should sort of be useful philosophy. It should be something useful for society. And the voices against the dominance of the scholastic values. The scholastic value in the sense that you should observe, stand aside, observe. You shouldn't sort of get in actually try to change things. So that rather than sort of was advocating this new kind of science, it's more practical rather than contemplative knowledge of nature. And part of this is also, once again, going back where this comes from. Well, part of this sort of this new perspective on what knowledge should serve is also coming from magic. Because in magic, of course, as I mentioned before, part of the magic is about observing and changing and manipulating the world, trying to do useful things, use knowledge to do useful things. So even though sort of it's not there clearly, that's part of sort of the ethos, you can say, of this new science, is this practical sort of application. And once again, alchemy and other sort of these sort of new, by this time old sort of bodies of knowledge are still something that many believe in, many practice. Alchemy, astrology, and so on and so forth, and magic, and so on. This is still sort of, this haven't left yet. I mean, this sort of, basically, it's by the 17th century that we see sort of the magic is sort of starting to be declining and leaving. But at this time, still sort of, we still, many believe and practice magic. Even though it's, of course, problematic, also sometimes you have to be secret about it, because by the church, that's often conceived to be heretic, of course, to do that. But then you also see a number of sort of, academic advocates as advocating this new kind of utilitarian philosophy. Agricola, Paracelsus are some of these sort of scholars that are so advocating that knowledge should be used for useful things. In mining, especially, if you take Agricola, and Paracelsus, of course, in medicine. And then you also have mechanical philosophers that are sort of learning from crafts practice, so that getting inspiration from crafts, from practical sort of activities, and then sort of getting inspired there. Especially, there's also been a big argument, if you look back at Galileo and Galilei, that he learned a lot of this sort of the experimentation by looking at how engineers and craftspeople, how they were working. And here is some, William Gilbert, he's a mathematical, or some mechanical physicist, you can say, focusing very much about magnetism and so on. And then you have Francis Bacon, which is one sort of, in many ways, you can say the philosopher or the statesman of science. He was a promoter of science. He was not so much a scientist himself, but he was very much sort of a promoter of science, a supporter of science. And he also sort of coined this phrase that knowledge is power. And once again, the point about what they meant by knowledge is power, through knowledge, we can achieve things in the world. We can also, the state can achieve things in the world. Through knowledge, we can sort of, by investing in knowledge, the state can also become more powerful politically. So this, from this point, so that when you see that science is actually being seen, that actually maybe science is not, might be very useful for practical purposes. And that's sort of what's called the Baconian research program coming at this time. That basically, that science should then sort of investigate how sort of practical matters. It should not just look at sort of the skies and try to explain everything around it. It should also sort of focus on practical issues, try to understand practical issues, which of course in the end sort of leads on. I'm going to skip that actually. Leads on for engineering science. Oops, come on. Why don't that? Okay, because I want to skip to this person, once again, Bacon, Francis Bacon. As I said, not so much a scientist himself, but very much a supporter of science. Once again, one of these persons, sort of not trained in natural philosophy, but trained in law, later on was elected member of parliament, and then actually become Lord Chancellor, which was the most powerful position in England, like the Prime Minister of today, you could say, that's the equivalent of the Prime Minister. And then, at the end of his life, he died out of scientific curiosity. He got bronchitis, basically. He was sort of out observing some scientific areas, and then caught bronchitis when he was looking at his experiment he was looking at outside. But as I say, once again, the importance of him was not the science, but the importance of him was sort of the support of science and launching a view, new view, a utilitarian view of science. He wrote a number of works where he sort of advocated for a more practically oriented natural philosophy, a natural philosophy in service of the state, helping out the state, not knowledge for its own sake or knowledge for theology, but knowledge for the state. And then the second part of this was Novum Organum, or the new tool, the new instrument, where he once again argued that Aristotelian logic was inadequate, the Aristotelian logic could not work to explain things, to explain practical and useful things, because Aristotelian logic, once again, was deductive, was using sort of known principles, and then from that deriving results, rather than inductive. So he was very much sort of in favor of the inductive method. You should observe and draw results from sort of through induction rather than through deduction. And then that continues, this work on this continues in Solomon's house, where he actually sort of advocates that you should establish state institutions for improvement of crafts and trades. I mean, academies, research laboratories, so that basically the state should then support scientific activities. And that became sort of then was known as Baconianism, or the knowledge is power program. But basically what he did that was reconceptualizing natural philosophy. He rejected the contemplative ideal. He renewed the focus on practically oriented natural philosophy, once again in service of the state, and also once again argued that so that the Aristotelian knowledge is inadequate for generating useful knowledge. And it should also be, that should be focused on novelty and new discoveries. And what you see here is the cover of one of his books, where he sort of have this sort of a ship that goes on off into the unknown towards new coasts to discover new things. That sort of this was his view about what science should be about. It should be go out discovering new things that then should, then could be brought back to where it came from, and sort of like tradesmen and others, you should go out and find new things that you could bring back home. Then, in that sense, many shall go to and fro, and knowledge shall increase. So basically, the idea that you should go out and discover, you should work to discover things, and that that could be useful for society in the end. And once again, that state institutions should, the state should actually devote some of their attention and money and power to improve crafts of various kinds. Because what he's arguing here, that actually that Western progress is built upon technological discoveries, especially putting forward the gunpowder and the compass. That's one of the sort of examples that he's using there. Look what the gunpowder and compass have given sort of the states here. So he thought we had to find more, new gunpowder, new compasses. So that's the legacy. Once again, Bacon, like Descartes, was not a great scientist, even though Descartes thought he was a great scientist. Bacon didn't think he was a great scientist, but their importance was dramatic, and but his importance was through an advocate for science. And also through his emphasis on the inductive method instead of, rather than the Aristotelian deductive method. And once again, he stressed the importance of experiments and the counter the threat of science reveal the glory of God. Okay, we're running out of time, but I cannot end without talking a little bit about this person, Isaac Newton, because this is sort of the end point of the scientific revolution. It's very shortly sort of Newton's life. My main point about Newton's life, he comes to Trinity College. That's sort of where sort of he starts flourishing as a scientist. And that's sort of where he's got interest in this new philosophy. And then this was actually 1 year, 1666, where sort of it's been known as the Annus Mirabilis, the wonderful year, where he does a number of large discoveries, central discoveries. Discovers or develops, however you want to see it, differential integrated calculus, new ideas about motion, and ideas about gravity and light. So the central discoveries. And then later on, a couple of years later, he becomes Lucasian Professor of Mathematics. And then in 1687, he publishes Principia Mathematica, which of course the central work of his time. But then later on, also, actually, he's also was one of these interesting people that he's not just focused on science, actually participating in practical things. And practicing in the state. He becomes a member of parliament for Cambridge University, and then actually have a nervous breakdown for years. That's not so good. But then in 1695, becomes master of the mint. So he becomes a bureaucrat, you can say, or a state servant. He becomes master of the mint, which basically means he's the one manufacturing the money of England for the state. So then he's in charge of manufacturing the money, minting. Currency at this time. And then he moves from Cambridge to London. And then in 1703 he becomes president of the Royal Society. And then in 1704 he published Optics, which is by many seen as sort of the end point of the scientific revolution. 1712 and he's knighted. And then dies in 1727. And in Newton, once again, is interesting because he's known as a mathematician, known as a physicist, but he's also very much one of these old traditions. He's a heretic. He's an alchemist. And once again, he's also one of these sort of combining these two sort of different knowledge traditions at the time. Mathematics, experimental physics, heresy, and alchemy. And there, I think I should end, even though I would like to speak much more, but just by showing you sort of the questions for next time. And I'm going to put this online, hopefully just in the break here, if not in a couple of hours. So this is what I want the questions for next time that I want you to answer and send in. Your take-home questions. Three questions. What discovery innovation of the scientific revolution do you consider to have the most important of today's society? Okay. And then, like I showed you a picture before of these sort of central new discoveries that the one person in 1580s did, that what he saw was like so illustrating the world. Now I want you to try to find something similar, not that picture, but something similar. You should find and present an image not shown in class that you consider best illustrates the essence of the scientific revolution, how you understand the scientific revolution. And basically the question should be connected to this period. The picture can be from today, but it should be illustrating something of the scientific revolution, this scientific revolution, before 1704, so to speak. And then the third question, how could today's world be if the scientific method had not been developed? Or how could scientific method be if a scientific method had not been developed? So this is sort of an exercise in sort of contrafactual history, as it's called. What if Hitler had been killed in 1939? What if there was no scientific method? How would the world be today? And of course, the point about this is for you to think through, as you've already been doing, sort of, what is the impact of scientific method? How could it look differently if, for instance, if scholasticism has still been the dominant sort of science of today, or if there had been another science, if the Cartesianism maybe, or something else? I mean, how would the world be today? Would it be different? Would it be the same? Would we still have iPods or not? So this, and then we're going to meet in class and we're going to talk more about these questions. Then we're going to spend basically about 45 minutes, you will just spend 45 minutes discussing this in groups and come up sort of with a shared answer to these questions. Okay? Questions? Comments? And you post them online before 8 o'clock. Okay. Thank you.